Tentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Badge Bunny by Nick Russell. Narrated by David Stifel. Chapter 1. Nobody in Somerton County took much notice when Leona Darling went missing. Not her mother, who was obsessed with daytime talk shows and primetime reality programming, and seldom left the couch except to nuke a TV dinner in the microwave and pour another glass of sweet tea. Not her father, who spent most of his time at the American Legion Hall reliving his glory days as a cook's assistant at Fort Sill, Oklahoma. And certainly not her younger sister, Jessie, who had recently discovered the thrills of bath salts, a synthetic drug that gave her an effect much like cocaine but was cheaper and easier to obtain. Jessie didn't notice much of anything these days. But really, who could blame them? Ever since Leona had developed boobs, she was gone a lot to who knows where. It was only after she failed to show up for court on a charge of driving on a suspended license and having no proof of insurance that anyone started looking for her. And that someone was Deputy John Lee Quarrels, the arresting officer. Judge Harrison Taylor had been on the bench for over 20 years and had earned a much-deserved reputation for fairness and honesty, but he had little patience for those who flaunted the law. When Leona missed her court date, the judge told John Lee to find her and bring her to him immediately. But finding Leona was not easily done. He tried calling her cell phone, but got a message saying her voice mailbox was full. Next, he tried her last known place of employment, where he learned she had been dismissed for showing up for her shift drunk. So John Lee drove out to the Darling home on Dogwood Road. It was a double-wide mobile home that looked like it had not seen a power washer or a paintbrush since it had been set in place back in the late 1980s. A huge satellite TV dish stood next to the house, and two large dogs chained to it barked at him when he got out of his patrol car. John Lee climbed the rickety wooden stairs and knocked on the door. Jessie Darling opened it and looked startled to see a police officer standing there. One look at her told John Lee that the girl was spaced out on something. She asked what he wanted, and he told her he needed to talk to Leona.
"She ain't here,"
Jessie said, slamming the door in his face. Lately, Jessie had been feeling depressed and paranoid, a result of her bath salts addiction, and the last thing she wanted was to find a cop standing at the door. Mary Lou Darling tried to ignore it when John Lee pounded on the mobile home's door again, but when he didn't stop, she finally heaved a heavy sigh and picked up the remote control to pause Dr. Phil and open the door. "I need to find Leona," John Lee told her. He wasn't the first man who had shown up at the door looking for her oldest daughter, and he certainly wasn't the ugliest.
"I ain't seen her in a while," Mary Lou said. "Did you check at Hog Wild Barbecue? I think she's working there."
"She got fired 2 weeks ago," John Lee replied.
"Maybe at the filling station?"
He shook his head. Lester canned her when she got in a fight with his daughter and called her a fat sow.
"Well, Nancy is a pretty good-sized gal."
"Yeah, she is," John Lee acknowledged. But Lester didn't feel that gave Leona the right to be saying things like that right there in the middle of the restaurant.
"Leona's got a mind of her own," her mother said, shrugging her shoulders. "Look, I got things to do. If I see her, I'll tell her you're looking for her."
John Lee drove back to town and stopped at the American Legion Hall to ask her father if he had seen Leona. But instead of an answer, he got a long lecture about how nobody appreciated the soldiers who worked behind the scenes.
"It ain't all guns and hand grenades and glory," Curtis Darling said. "They say an army moves on its stomach. Well, who the hell do you think fills those stomachs? But does anybody ever build a statue to the cucks? Hell no."
John Lee left about the time Curtis began telling him how keeping his hands immersed in all those greasy pots and pans over the years had caused arthritis. But would the VA give him a disability for that? Hell no.
It just ain't right,
Curtis was saying as the deputy walked out the door.
It just ain't right at all.
And so it went all day long. Nobody John Lee talked to had seen Leona or the old blue Mazda pickup she drove. No one in her family, none of the regulars in the bars where she hung out, not her aunt or uncle, and not Mary Lou Nelson and the other three women who worked at the cutesy Cuts and Curl, where Leona had a standing appointment every other Thursday afternoon to get her hair styled and her nails done. He talked to several other deputies and the officers of the tiny Somerton police force. Leona was a familiar face to all of them, but nobody knew where she was or could recall the last time they saw her. John Lee even struck out with her two favorite drinking buddies, Crystal Tobins and Holly Griggs, and if they didn't know where she was, nobody did. As it turned out, somebody in Somerton County knew where Leona Darling was, and they weren't saying anything. Chapter 2. Clyde Freeman, owner of Freeman's Friendly Used Cars, was growing frustrated waiting for Leona to come in and make a payment on her 2003 Mazda pickup. He'd been patient at first, knowing that the girl was a flake in spite of her good looks. Or maybe he had been patient because of her good looks. But either way, it wasn't long before his patience began wearing thin. Clyde, who was well known in Somerton County for peddling clunkers for just an easy $99 down and $99 a month, as his advertising constantly reminded shoppers, never expected Leona to pay off the truck. Hell, most folks never paid off a vehicle they bought from Clyde. His interest rates and carrying charges saw to that. But they usually managed to keep them running long enough for him to recoup his minimal investment in the vehicle, since he bought them at auction and only purchased ones that no other dealer would take, and his profit came from the above-stated interest and carrying charges. Then, when the old car or truck broke down for the last time and the buyer came to Clyde to complain, he reminded them of what he had told them back when they signed their contract. If it breaks in half going home, you get to keep both halves. But Clyde was a good old boy, and he sure didn't want to see you walking when you could be riding, no sir. So he'd take that old car of yours in on trade and sell you another one under the same terms. And after Clyde had the boys out back in the garage clean that trade-in of yours up a little bit and put it back together with spit and baling wire, he'd park it back on his lot, and before you knew it, some other sucker would buy it, and the process would start all over again. Yep, Clyde was a good old boy. Lots of times Clyde had to repo a car, and that was okay too. They had to be pretty banged up before they were too worn out to patch up and resell. Usually, if you were 2 weeks late with your payment and hadn't contacted him, Clyde sent his brother-in-law, Harvey, to pick up the car. Harvey was a big old boy with long, scraggly hair and bad teeth, whose thick arms were covered in tattoos. He wore a heavy ring on each of his fingers that could do more harm to a man than brass knuckles, and he never smiled. Folks didn't usually argue with Harvey when he pulled up in the tow truck. Clyde never expected Leona to repay him, but at least she would make the effort and come in with $20 or $30 every couple of weeks. That would never satisfy the loan, but Leona always wore blue jean shorts cropped off at just about crotch level, or skirts that weren't much longer, and she was good to look at. It helped that she always made a point of leaning way over his desk while she told him about how her latest job as a car hop at the Dogs and Suds or as a cashier at the Quick Stop hadn't worked out, but she was going to get her account caught up. IGA hadn't worked out, but she was going to find a job real soon, yes, sir. And then she'd be in real soon, yes, sir, cross her heart and hope to die. so Clyde had held off and given Leona more leeway than he usually did. It wasn't like he was going to go hungry giving her some slack. And who knew? Maybe someday they might figure out another way for her to satisfy the loan. Leona had been drooling over that fire engine red Pontiac Firebird for a while now. Maybe she could trade that old pickup in, and they could work something out that was beneficial to both of them. But a man can only be so patient, and even Clyde had his limits. So when 5 weeks had rolled around with no sign of Leona, and calls to her cell phone had gone unanswered, he decided enough was enough and told Harvey to go get the Mazda. Harvey started out following in John Lee's footsteps and getting the same response. Nobody had seen Leona and nobody knew where she was. Clyde only paid Harvey when he returned a repossessed car to his lot. If he didn't find it, he got nothing for his time and trouble, so Harvey persisted. And he wasn't quite as good-natured as the deputy, nor was he hampered by some of the rules John Lee had to follow.
"I swear I don't know where she is. If I did, I'd tell ya,"
Holly Griggs whined, terrified of the hulk looming over her. She took a step backward, feeling the wall pressing against her back, cutting off any avenue of retreat. Everybody knew Harvey Richards was no man to mess with. She had heard stories about him stomping people in the gravel parking lots of Somerton County's beer joints, and there was talk that he had killed a man in a bar up across the state line in Georgia.
"Don't lie to me, bitch. Tell me where she is."
Harvey smelled bad, and when he reached out a grimy hand and poked her in the chest with his finger, Holly winced.
"I'm not lying to you. I ain't seen her in a long time."
"When's the last time you saw her?"
"I don't remember for sure."
"Well, you damn sure better remember if you know what's good for you."
"Let me think. Last time I recall seeing her was at least 3 weeks ago. Toward the end of last month. We was all at a kegger out at Baker Point and she was there."
"Bullshit," Harvey growled. "You and her and Crystal are together all the time."
"I swear I ain't seen her," Holly repeated. "Not since that night at the Point."
"If I find that you're lying to me, I'm going to come back and rip your tits off."
To emphasize his point, Harvey grabbed her left nipple between his thumb and index finger and twisted viciously, grinning when Holly yelped with pain. Harvey liked inflicting pain on people. The young woman sobbed and moaned.
"I ain't lying. I really don't know where she is."
Harvey released her and stepped back, watching Holly slide to the floor. Jimmy McMichael stood staring at the confrontation with his mouth open, unsure what to do. Harvey shouldered his way past him, bouncing the 19-year-old boy against a stainless steel table covered in pizza dough on his way out. He wasn't worried about a little shithead like Jimmy getting in his way. Nobody got in Harvey's way when he was looking for somebody.
"Are you okay?"
Jimmy asked, leaning down to help Holly back to her feet once they were alone.
"As okay as I'm gonna be."
Harvey's dirty fingers had left a smudge on her white t-shirt that Jimmy tried not to look at. Ever since she had started working at Pizza City, Jimmy had spent a lot of time trying not to look at Holly's boobs as they strained against the front of her shirt, but with little success.
"Do you think we should call the cops?" "Are you crazy?"
Holly asked incredulously.
"Do you want to get us both killed?" "No, but I don't know what to do." "Nothing, Jimmy. Don't do nothing. Just like you did when that big ape was grabbing onto me. And stop staring at my boobs, you pimply-faced little perv."
Holly pushed him out of her way and pulled her phone from the back pocket of her tight jeans. She punched the button and listened for a moment, and when the call was answered, she said,
"Crystal, we got trouble. Big trouble."
Chapter 3. While Holly Griggs was dealing with Harvey, John Lee was the target of another bully's wrath.
I don't give a rat's ass what the judge told you to do. I said I want you out at the high school slowing those kids down when they get out of class,
Chief Deputy Flag Newton said.
We've had 3 accidents in the last month, and that's on you, John Lee. You ride around in that fancy charger acting like you're some kind of hot shit, instead of working the road like every other deputy has to. Well, that bullshit's going to stop, and it's going to stop right now.
Flag was a big man, with a shaved head and a walrus mustache, who had hated John Lee from the minute the younger man had pinned on a deputy's badge. Part of it was because John Lee was the son-in-law of Sheriff D.W. Swindle, who also happened to be Flag's brother-in-law. As far as Flag was concerned, D.W. was a disgrace. He was nothing but a good old boy politician who cared more about slapping backs and kissing voters' asses than he did law enforcement. Flag considered himself the much better man for the job of sheriff, and he made no secret of the fact that someday it would be him sitting behind the big desk. The other reason Flag despised John Lee so much was because the smartass had absolutely no respect for authority. Sure, him and D.W. got along because he was such a brown noser, and maybe he had all the other deputies convinced he was the greatest thing since sliced bread. But to Flag, John Lee was no more than a punk. A punk whose time was coming. It was bad enough that he strutted around the department like he owned the place. But John Lee had gone too far a few months earlier when he had sucker-punched Flag in front of the whole damn department and even a couple of dickheads from the FBI. The little bastard had gotten lucky that time, catching him unaware like that, but it wouldn't happen again. But what hurt and enraged Flag more than the punch was the fact that just because John Lee had shot some greaseball drug dealer right before the incident, everybody acted like he was some kind of a hero. Oh yeah, that little prick's time was coming, and it wouldn't be long. Typical of John Lee, instead of doing as ordered, the deputy had a smart comeback. "I'll tell you what, Fig," he had said, using the nickname that Flag hated. "How about you and me go talk to Judge Taylor? And as long as he's okay with me not following his orders, I'll be happy to park my ass at the high school and stare at all those pretty girls walking by."
"Don't you push me, deputy. You get away with that shit with D.W., but not with me."
Other deputies knew their place and would have backed down, but not John Lee. Instead, he had to get the last word in. "You can talk as big as you want to, Fig, but we both know that when it comes right down to it, you're all talk and no action. I knocked you on your ass once, and any time you need a reminder of that, you just let me know." With that, he spun on his heel and walked out, leaving a red-faced chief deputy behind him. After 2 days with no success, and with no other ideas on how to track down Leona Darling, John Lee decided to talk to his boss about it. He found D.W. in his office, staring at a stack of papers on his desk with a scowl. Knocking on the open door, John Lee asked, "Got a minute?"
"You know anything about hazardous waste? Are you talking about the crap that spews out of Fig's mouth every day? Or is this some other kind of hazardous waste?"
"I got this from the State Division of Waste Management, wanting to know all kinds of stuff about how we deal with hazardous waste around here."
"What kind of waste?"
"That's just it. I never heard of any of this stuff," D.W. complained. "What the hell are oil dielectric fluids? And did you ever hear of mercury being in fluorescent lamps? What kind of mercury? Are they talking about the cars or the stuff in thermometers?"
"I think they stopped making mercury cars a few years ago," John Lee told him. "And I'm pretty sure they don't use mercury in thermometers anymore either."
"Well then, why is the state bothering me with all this nonsense? I've got better things to do with my time than worrying about thermometers and fluorescent lights and cars they don't even make anymore. Damn bureaucrats!"
If D.W. saw the irony in his comment, he didn't acknowledge it.
"Anyway, what do you need, John Lee?"
Judge Taylor has had me looking for this Leona Darling, and I've looked high and low, and I can't find her anywhere. Well, she ain't in here, but if she knows anything about this hazardous waste stuff, I'd be glad to see her. I'm just wondering what you would think about putting out an APB on her. An all-points bulletin? For not showing up for court on traffic offenses? I never heard of that before. Why don't the judge just issue a bench warrant and wait until somebody gets her on a traffic stop or something? It's not that big a county. I don't think she can avoid us forever. Here's the thing, John Lee said. You're right. It's not that big of a county. And this girl is a party animal who's always somewhere. But nobody's seen her in a month or so. It's like she just dropped off the face of the earth. Everybody's someplace, John Lee. I know that, but I sure as hell can't figure out where this girl is right now. Well, you just keep plugging away at it. She'll turn up. I don't see no reason to put out an APB over something like this. Okay, I'll get back at it, John Lee said with a sigh and stood up. As he started at the door, D.W. asked, Have you talked to Emily lately? No, not in a while. She was over to the house yesterday. Brought that woman with her, which really upset her mama. I don't know what to say, D.W. Emily Quarrels was John Lee's estranged wife, a good-looking woman who would never have thought of leaving the house without her makeup just right and her hair brushed to perfection. She had left John Lee over a year ago, saying she needed to find herself. She was currently in a live-in relationship with a woman named Sarah, but seemed to want to have the best of both worlds, showing up at his place unannounced every week or two to spend the night. The first few times it happened, he had been hopeful that life was going to get back to normal, but it never had. She would leave the next day with promises that were never kept. He never knew what triggered Emily's need to come back home, or why it never lasted more than a few hours. And as time went on, he had grown less hopeful of any kind of a permanent reconciliation. This whole thing's a mess, John Lee. I didn't raise either one of my girls to do the things they're doing. I know you didn't, John Lee said, not really wanting to have this conversation again. A few months after he and Emily split up, he had found himself involved with her younger sister, Beth Ann. He didn't plan it that way, and he didn't seek her out, knowing it was a mistake the first time it happened. And while his sister-in-law shrugged off his concerns by saying,
It's just sex, that's all,
he couldn't completely accept her casual approach to things. But it takes two to tango, and it wasn't like Beth Ann overpowered him and forced him into bed time and time again. John Lee had hoped to keep the casual affair a secret, but that was impossible. There were no secrets in Somerton County. It wasn't long before D.W. had stopped at his house one morning, only to find his youngest daughter making coffee in John Lee's kitchen, wearing just her panties and one of his t-shirts. Things had been strained between the sheriff and the deputy ever since, though D.W. was no fool. He knew that both of his daughters were strong-headed, independent women who did what they wanted and damned the consequences. Well, don't be surprised if she shows up before long. D.W., I need to get out there and keep looking for this girl the judge wants me to find. Yeah, I know. I'm just saying, don't be surprised if you get company. In case you have other company at the time, things could get complicated. Like they weren't already complicated enough. John Lee had not told the sheriff that the last time Emily had come to his house, in their post-coital pillow talk, she had raised the possibility of moving back home if they could have an open marriage. John Lee was no prude by any means, and his reputation as a player was not entirely undeserved, but deep down inside, he really was a one-woman man. He had had opportunities, but never considered straying while Emily and he were still living together. When he made it clear that he wasn't interested in the arrangement she suggested, they had had an argument, and John Lee had thrown her out. He had not seen her since, so he was somewhat surprised at D.W.'s suggestion that she might be coming by. There was a time when he would have been excited at the opportunity to be with Emily again, but by now he knew in his heart that it really was over. Too much had happened, and the gap between them was too wide to ever close again. "Thanks for the heads up," John Lee said, nodding at the sheriff, and leaving before the conversation could go any further. Chapter 4. Deputy Madison Westfall considered herself to be a nice person, and always tried to be fair when going about her duties. It didn't matter if you were driving a brand new luxury car or a rusty old beater pickup, whether she pulled you over for speeding or because you had too much to drink and couldn't keep it between the lines on the highway. Maddie was always courteous and respectful. And she had seen and heard it all in her time as a deputy. Those who claimed they weren't speeding and those who admitted they were, but only because they had to go to the bathroom. Those who swore that they only had one or two drinks, though they reeked of alcohol and slurred their words. Those who looked past the badge and saw the tall, leggy blonde with gray eyes, and either dismissed her out of hand or tried to put a move on her. But the balding man in the white Oldsmobile was a first for her. Maybe it was the fact that he was wearing a hot pink halter top and matching short shorts. Or it could have been the heavy makeup that wasn't able to conceal his 5 o'clock shadow. Or maybe it was the red fishnet stockings and stiletto heels he was wearing when she got him out of the car. But whatever it was, Maddie was having a hard time maintaining her composure. She had pulled the sedan over for doing 55 in a 35-mile-per-hour speed zone, and while she was waiting for the driver to find his registration and proof of insurance, had observed him pulling a white bag with some kind of powder in it out of the car's glove compartment.
"What's in the bag?" Maddie asked.
"Nothing, just talcum powder." Opening the car's door, Maddie ordered the driver to get out.
"Why?"
"Because I have reason to believe that you have drugs in this car."
"No, I don't."
"People don't usually carry talcum powder around in a Ziploc bag," she had told him.
"I do. Sometimes I chafe."
"Out of the car."
"I really don't want to do that."
As nice as she could be, Maddie had learned early on that a deputy had to take control of the situation at the beginning to keep things from getting out of hand. Especially a young, good-looking female deputy.
"It wasn't a request, sir. Get out of the car."
"Can we go someplace more private first?"
"No, sir, we can't."
"But I didn't do anything wrong."
"Then you've got nothing to worry about. Standing alongside the highway in broad daylight dressed like this is something to worry about." "Well, I didn't dress you before you left home, so I guess that's your problem. Out of the car. Now!"
With an exaggerated sigh, the man got out, and Maddie directed him to the back of the Oldsmobile, calling on her radio for another officer as she did so. Two cars passed, their drivers honking their horns at the unusual sight.
"Put your hands on the trunk and keep them there, please."
"Miss, this really isn't necessary. I swear, the only thing in that bag is talcum powder."
"Please address me as deputy, sir. I'm going to pat you down just as a precaution. You don't have any weapons or anything sharp on you that's going to poke me, do you?"
"Where would I hide it?"
Maddie didn't even want to think about that as she went through the motions of searching the man. Finding nothing on him, she walked him down the passenger side of her cruiser and put him in the back seat.
"You just sit tight, okay?"
"Am I under arrest?"
"Not at this time. It depends on what I find inside your car."
"Do you have a search warrant?"
"I don't need one.
I have probable cause to believe there are drugs in the car."
"What probable cause?"
"That bag of suspicious powder you had in your glove compartment."
"I told you, it's talcum powder."
"Then I guess you don't have anything to worry about, do you?"
"You're going to look really silly when you find out it really is talcum powder in that bag," the man said.
Maddie was tempted to tell him that she wasn't the one dressed up like a street corner hooker, so looking silly wasn't very high on her list of concerns at the moment. Instead, she just closed the police car's door. Calling the dispatcher, she ran the car's license plate and the driver for wants or warrants, and both came back to a Miami address and were clean. As she walked back to the Oldsmobile, a Dodge Charger painted in the colors of the Somerton County Sheriff's Office pulled up behind her car. She smiled when John Lee got out and walked up to where she was standing. "What do you got?"
"I'm not sure what I've got. Did you see the person in the back seat of my car?"
"I didn't pay any attention. Why?"
"Go see for yourself."
She watched as John Lee walked back to her car, opened the rear door, and talked to the Oldsmobile's driver for a moment. Smirking as the other deputy returned to her, she asked,
"Did you get an eyeful?"
"Oh, yeah. What's his story?"
"I don't know, and I don't want to know," Maddie replied. Wearing latex gloves, they searched the car. Except for two sex toys and an assortment of ribbed condoms, the only suspicious thing they found was the plastic bag with the powder in it.
"He says it's talcum powder," Maddie said as she pulled a surgical mask over her face and scooped some of the suspicious substance into the pouch of the field test kit. Closing the pouch, she squeezed it with her fingers to break the capsule inside and then shook it. Both deputies were surprised when the substance did not turn blue, indicating the presence of narcotics.
"What the hell is this stuff?"
"I don't know," John Lee said, sniffing the bag.
"Stop! Jesus, John Lee! If that had fentanyl in it, it could have killed you."
"Relax. It didn't test as drugs, Maddie."
"I don't care. You can't be too careful."
She shook her head at her friend's sometimes brashness and asked,
"If it's not drugs, what do you think it is?"
"Smells like talcum powder to me."
"Like you know what talcum powder smells like. Tell me you don't chafe, too."
"What?"
"Never mind," Maddie said.
She walked back to her car, opened the rear door, and told the man to get out.
"I told you it was talcum powder," he said testily. "Yeah, I know. You chafe," Maddie replied. "Look, I don't know what your thing is, and I really don't want to know. Just get in your car and go back to Miami and stay there, okay?" "You waste my time. Humiliate me by parading me out in front of the whole world dressed like this, treat me like I'm some kind of common criminal, and go through my car without any regard to my privacy, and now you want me to just go like nothing happened?" "Yes, sir. Just go." "I don't think so, miss. I mean, deputy. You can't treat people that way and then expect them to forget about it and go on their way."
"Really?"
"Yes, really."
"So you can't just get in your car and leave? You need to make a thing out of this?"
"I told you there were no drugs in the car to start with."
"Yes, you did," Maddie replied. "And I told you to go ahead and go. Are you going to do that?"
He folded his hands across his chest and shook his head.
"Not just like that. I want an apology or something."
"Okay," Maddie said, nodding her head.
"I'm not going to apologize for doing my job, but I will give you something."
She took out her ticket book and cited the man for speeding.
"That's not fair."
"Life isn't fair," Maddie said. "This isn't an admission of guilt, just a promise to appear in court. There are four copies there. Press hard when you sign."
"What if I refuse to sign that thing?"
"Then I take you to jail," Maddie said. "And I'll probably forget to use the back entrance where we usually take prisoners. And instead, I'll take you right down the main hallway of the courthouse and downstairs. Then I'll put you in a cell with four or five big old redneck boys. Now, depending on your mood, you may or not enjoy that. Either way, it's not my problem. Like I said, four copies, press hard."
Standing in front of her car watching the Oldsmobile drive away, Maddie shook her head and said,
"Every day's an adventure, isn't it?"
"You know, if you were to get yourself an outfit like that,"
what with those fishnets and the heels and the tiny little shorts with half your butt hanging out. You might be able to change your luck, Maddie.
If I thought that would do the trick, I'd be online ordering a get-up like that right now.
Don't write checks with your mouth your ass can't cash, John Lee told her. Hey, got a question for you. What do you know about Leona Darling?
Really, John Lee? I'm standing here throwing myself at you, and you ask about that skank?
No, seriously, what do you know about her?
I know enough so that I think you're better off chasing down that Oldsmobile if you're that hard up.
I take it you don't have a very high opinion of her.
You could say that.
How come?
I told you she's a slut, Maddie snapped.
I know she parties a lot, but I didn't know she sleeps around.
Oh, trust me, John Lee. Anytime that girl's in a horizontal position, there's a pretty good chance she's not sleeping.
Whatever. Judge Taylor is on my ass to find her. She didn't show up for court, and this is like the third or fourth time she's done that. He's pissed, and when I do bring her in, he's going to throw the book at her. Realizing that her friend's interest in the woman wasn't personal, but rather business, Maddie started to relax somewhat.
Talk to Mike Honeycutt. Or maybe Tommy Moultrie. All the guys know Leona. I'm surprised you don't.
I know who she is, John Lee said. And I know she gets around. I popped her a while back for driving suspended, which is the charge she didn't show up for court on this time around and set the judge off. That's the only time I've ever had anything to do with her.
Well, then, that puts you in the minority, Maddie said.
As she spoke, a blue Chevrolet pickup with a loud exhaust flew past them at a high rate of speed. Is that the Turner kid?
Yes,
Maddie said, shaking her head in frustration.
I gave that little puke a fix-it ticket 2 weeks ago. He's always got money for pot and beer, but says he can't afford a muffler.
This time I'm going to nail his ass. As she climbed behind the wheel of her patrol car, she asked,
Want to get a pizza later?
Sounds good to me. I'll see you there after shift. Maddie nodded and put her car into gear, pulling onto the road and turning on her blue and red roof lights as she took off after Ricky Turner. Chapter 5 Tommy Moultrie lived in a three-bedroom ranch-style house on Dauphin Street, 4 blocks from the center of town. Ever since his wife had left him the previous summer, a cadre of different deputies and state patrol officers had used his 2 extra bedrooms as crash pads when problems on the home front got to be too much, and they either left or were told to leave. Most only stayed a night or two before patching up things at home, though a couple had stayed as long as a month. Tommy missed Luann for the first week or two, but he sure didn't miss her constant complaining if he forgot to wipe his feet before coming in the door, or if he left his dirty uniform on the bedroom floor, or if he wanted to watch a ball game and drink a few beers on his day off instead of mowing the grass. Come to think of it, all he really missed was her cooking and the sex, and there hadn't been much of either the last few months as their relationship deteriorated. It didn't take Tommy long to figure out that he could get anything he needed to eat at a drive-through window or by showing up back at his parents' house at supper time. As for the sex, Tommy was a nice-looking young man with a great smile and a good sense of humor, so he wasn't deprived in that department for very long either. The door to Tommy's attached 2-car garage was open when John Lee pulled in the driveway and parked next to another Somerton County sheriff's car. The 4 off-duty officers standing around Tommy's pool table drinking beer all greeted him.
Hey there, John Lee. Want a cold one? Wish I could, but I'm still on duty. Be just my luck that Fig would drive by and see me. Screw Fig, Bob Patterson said. If he gives you any shit, knock him on his ass again, John Lee. I've been tempted to more than once.
I heard that.
So, you just out slumming, or did you come by to see what the beautiful people are doing?
Actually, guys, I'm looking for some information.
I've been trying to find Leona Darling for a couple of days now,
and I just keep hitting a brick wall everywhere I turn.
Leona, why are you setting your sight so much lower, John Lee?
What do you mean?
Hey, I don't judge anybody, Mike Honeycutt said. Especially not when I've been there myself.
That brought a round of laughter from the men in the garage.
No, that's not your style, son, Patterson said. Maybe Honeycutt can't do better, but you can.
More laughter, and Honeycutt threw his empty Budweiser can at Patterson.
John Lee don't need to be chasing no badge bunny like Leona, said Emmett Planter,
one of the four officers with the city police force.
Shit, y'all. This here boy sees more pussy than a gynecologist.
Everybody laughed, and John Lee couldn't help smiling at the crude comment. It wasn't true, of course, but he sure wasn't going to let them know that. No, I just need to take her in to see Judge Taylor. She didn't show up for court, and he told me I've got to find her.
You asked me that the other day, said Honeycutt. I haven't seen her around in a while. How about you guys?
Not that I can remember. Now that you mention it, Tommy replied. Did you check with Holly Griggs and Crystal Tobin's? Usually when you see one of them, the other two ain't far off.
I've checked everywhere. With those two, with her mama and daddy and her sister, and at every gin mill in the county. Nobody's seen her for a while.
Did you try unzipping your pants and pulling your Johnson out? That's usually all it takes with Leona,
Emmett said, drawing another round of laughter from the other three men in the garage. You know, I never knew that about her, John Lee admitted.
Say what y'all went and done. Once she gets her lips round this pretty boy, Leona ain't going to have time for the rest of us anymore. Don't you worry, Tommy, Honeycutt said. John Lee's not greedy. He'll share. Way I heard it, old Leona's gonna have to stand in line between that girl deputy of y'all's and that little nigger he's putting the meat to, and the sheriff's...
That's enough of that talk, Emmett, John Lee said.
What?
The city policeman drained his can and burped.
I'm condemning you, John Lee. Hell, I wish I was getting half the nookie you are. Does that brown stuff really taste like chocolate?
John Lee took a step toward the grinning redneck cop, his fists balled. Patterson stepped in front of him and put a hand on his chest.
Let it go, John Lee. He's just had too much to drink and he's shooting his mouth off. He don't mean nothing by it.
I don't need you fighting my fights for me, Patterson,
Emmett said.
You got a problem, John Lee?
You're the one with the problem, and it's that loud mouth of yours. You'd best be keeping it closed around me.
Or what?
Emmett started around the pool table toward him and was intercepted by Honeycutt.
Back off, Emmett. He's the one needs to back off,
Emmett shouted, pointing his finger at John Lee.
Poking his pecker at everything that moves and then wanting to take offense when somebody says something about it. Y'all know it's true. Hey, John Lee. Why don't we see if that nigger girlfriend of yours has got a girlfriend or sister? They could put you in the middle and make a Oreo.
That's enough. Emmett, you need to get on out of here if you're going to be acting that way, Tommy said.
Shit, what is this? SL against the police department? We was all getting along just fine till John Lee showed up. Just because my uniform's blue and y'all's is tan ain't no reason to come down on me when he started it.
That's okay. He's had too much to drink to be driving, John Lee said. I've got to get back on the road anyway and see if I can find that girl.
He went back to the Charger, still fuming. Bob Patterson followed him and leaned in the window.
Don't pay it no mind, John Lee. We all know he's an asshole.
Yeah, I know. But one of these days he's going to go too far.
I don't doubt that, buddy. But let's not make it today and not here, okay?
Yeah, you're right.
Thanks, Bob. I'll catch you later.
He started the Charger and backed out of the driveway, headed back toward town. His hands were tight on the steering wheel, and he wanted nothing more than to make a U-turn and go back and pound Emmett's face into mush. John Lee knew that Emmett wasn't the only racist in Somerton County. Not by a long shot. When it came right down to it, he wouldn't be surprised if more than one person who wore a badge during the day didn't put on a white hood and sheet at night. And John Lee knew that his relationship with Shania Jones was bound to create a lot of talk in town. A white cop and a black woman, even in today's South, wasn't all that common. But let them gossip all they wanted to, even if most of what they suspected wasn't true. Shania was a tiny African-American woman in her mid-20s who wore her hair in cornrows and had a beautiful smile and a disarming sense of humor. She worked as a forensic pathologist at the state crime lab in Tallahassee, and John Lee was as attracted to her for her intelligence and quick wit as he was for her looks. The local gossip mongers would probably be surprised to learn that, except for a quick kiss of greeting and on parting now and then, nothing physical had happened between them. Not that Shania hadn't teased him endlessly with innuendos, leaving John Lee to wonder exactly what their relationship was and where it was headed, if anywhere. While he certainly had entertained the idea of taking it to the next level, he wasn't pushing the issue. He had been around long enough and bedded enough women in his time to know that a night or a weekend of passion was fleeting, while real friendships that stood the test of time were hard to come by. As for Maddie, that was another relationship whose future he wasn't sure about. 3 years younger than him, her brother Dan had been John Lee's best friend when they were growing up. Dan was always telling John Lee that his kid sister had a crush on him, but John Lee had just laughed it off. They lost Dan when he drowned swimming in the Suwannee River when they were 17, a tragedy that had destroyed his family. His parents' marriage ended, and his father moved away, only to die a few years after his son's death in a one-vehicle accident down around Ocala. Nobody ever knew if it was caused by his high blood alcohol level or if it was suicide. Maddie's mother had remarried twice, neither relationship lasting more than a few months. Becoming more and more withdrawn, she seldom left her bedroom. So while she was still just a girl, Madison had been forced to become the adult in the family, paying the bills from the monthly Social Security check and an annuity from her father's life insurance policy, and shouldering all of the other household duties. She had handled it all with a maturity far beyond her years, and still managed to graduate at the top of her high school class. John Lee had been the one constant in her life, the only thing that she knew was always there for her. As the years went on, their friendship had become just as important to him as it was to her. But neither could deny that there was more to it than that, nor would they admit to the occasional fantasy out loud. Instead, they handled it with banter and harmless flirtation, camouflaged as satire more often than not. And though both had been tempted more than once to throw caution to the winds and let whatever might happen, they had always paused on the brink of the abyss and then stepped back. Sometimes John Lee thought life would have been a lot simpler if he had become a priest and taken a vow of celibacy instead of becoming a deputy. Chapter 6.
Jeez, who peed in your Cheerios? What's with the long face, John Lee?
It's nothing, he said, sitting down across from her in a booth at the pizza parlor. Did you order yet?
Nope, I just got here a couple minutes ago. But I did get your glass.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.